Hello, Stats Class. This is Lesson 11 2A, which is the beginning of inference for relationships. So because we're beginning a new topic, I want to remind you of where we've been. Categorical data. We have done a bunch of stuff with categorical data. So let's just review a little bit. In chapters 8 and 9, remember chapter 8 was confidence intervals, chapter 9 was significance tests. Both of those, we just did a single proportion. Which meant we were looking at success or failure, and just two categories and a single population. And then in chapter 10, we expanded that to go to two proportions. Two populations, comparing them. And in both of these situations, it was binary, which means we only allowed two categories, success and failure. So the most complicated we got in chapter 10 is when we did a two-way table for chapter 10, where we just did like a two-by-two two-way table. We had our first population and our second population. We had successes and failures and nothing else. And of course, you can add the totals onto the edges if you want to. But basically, that was in chapter 10. We did this type. And it didn't get more complicated than that yet, right? Chapter 11 is where we expand to do more than two categories. Specifically, I'm talking about 11.1, where we had many categories. In other words, we're not binary anymore. We're allowing more categories, and that's kind of fun. Except in 11.1, we still only had one population, right? One population, one categorical variable, that was 11.1. And that categorical variable just could have more than two categories, right? Have you guessed where we're going in 11.2? I kind of implied it a second ago. So here's where we're going with the new lesson. That's all the old stuff. In 11.2, we're going to have more than one population. Oh my goodness. And or more than two categories. So we've actually already seen the two population thing in chapter 10, where we had two populations and successes and failures. In 11, we could have two populations and more categories, so we could just add more rows to this table. So more than two categories would add more rows to our two-way table, or we could have two populations, or maybe even three or four populations, or more we could have as many populations as we want, and that would be more columns added onto our table. So we're just making this this is really messy, sorry, it's supposed to say columns, I'm going to make it better. So we could add as many columns or rows as we need to compare as many populations as we want with as many categories as we want. Isn't that exciting? We're going to have bigger two-way tables. There we go. So the test that we are learning that does that is called a chi-square test, of course. But it's not goodness of fit anymore. It's called homogeneity. So homogeneity has to do with the categorical variable distribution being the same. Homogeneity means same distribution. So we're going to have two or more populations. I'm not going to limit it to just two. And we want to see if the distribution of a particular categorical variable is the same for each population. Or maybe it's not the same. That's what we're heading towards. And we're only doing the very beginning of this for this first lesson. We'll do the formal four steps in lesson 2B, but for now it's just, can you write, how do you do the hypotheses? How do you deal with the calculations? That's all we're going to worry about for right now. So hypotheses, they actually are kind of what you would expect, that the null is that everything's the same. It's the dull one. The null is that all the populations, however many you have the same proportions. So that's that same distribution idea. And of course you would add your context, which is your, what are your populations and what is your variable? And then the alternate is going to be the same as what we did for goodness of fit. It's that at least one proportion is different. We don't care if they're all different, just at least one is different. And notice that instead of we're comparing to a hypothetical set of proportions, we're comparing to the other populations. So that's a little bit of a difference. Comparing the populations to each other instead of to a hypothetical list of proportions. I'm going to abbreviate that because I'm on the edge of my page. But hypothetical list of proportions is what that means, in case you couldn't figure that out. So that's a change. The good news is a lot of it is the same as goodness of fit. So you already know how to do a lot of it. Here's some good news. The conditions are the same. We're not going to talk about them today. We'll get that in the four steps tomorrow. It has a goodness of fit test. So I don't really need to talk about them. I will do it in an example on 11.2b. Almost the same calculations. So I'm going to talk about how the calculations change, and then the conclusions also almost the same. So how is it the same and how is it different? That's what we're going to talk about. Our chi-squared formula has not changed. It is still the sum of the observed minus the expected, I hope you have this one almost memorized by now, squared over the expected. That's still the same as before. The observed counts are going to be in a two-way table, and usually that two-way table is given to you. And we'll talk some more about that in a minute. The p-value, we're still going to find by doing chi-square CDF. And we're going to put our chi-squared and some big number and df. Df changes a little bit when we have a two-way table. We can't do number of categories minus one anymore because now we have more columns. So instead of just us, technically, it'd be like a one-way table. Goodness of fit would be just this, except more rows to it. And now we're going two directions. So that makes it a little more complicated. Df is now going to be the number of columns minus one. Ah, I can't spell columns today. Times the number of rows minus one. And that actually does make sense. And let me tell you why it makes sense. Let's look at a two-way table example, and I'm just going to do very lightweight examples today. I'm not going to put context in this or anything. I'm just going to say, let's say we have three populations. And let's say we have four categories. So So let's talk about why it makes sense for DF to be columns minus one times rows minus one. What this means is, so in this particular example, I have three columns and I have four rows. And so 3 minus 1 is 2, 4 minus 1 is 3, 2 times 3 is 6. That would be my DF. Why is it 6? Because if I knew the totals, so let's say I happen to know, we've done problems like this before where we know the totals. I'm just going to make up some numbers. And these happen to add up to 140 is my sample size. And let's say I have these three numbers, which also add up to 140. If I knew all of these numbers, and let's say I was trying to fill in the table and I knew some stuff. So I could calculate this one, or like maybe I'm given these first two, and I could find the third one by subtracting it, right? So if I knew this and I knew this, I could find this one. And same thing if I knew these two. If I knew the first two columns, I could find the third column by subtracting. And so that third column is actually not necessary to be given to me because I know the totals. So if you cross off or get rid of that column and say, okay, I don't really need that column. And then also I could, if I knew the first three rows, I could find the fourth row. So maybe I don't need that fourth row because I could find that also by subtracting these totals minus this stuff. So the stuff that I actually need to know is only 6 boxes. That's the 6 right there. It's how many boxes you have to know in order to find the rest by subtracting. Technically, they're called cells, not boxes. So that's a very simplistic explanation, but it works. Just think about getting rid of a row and a column, and whatever's left, that's DF, or number of columns minus one, number of rows minus one. That works. All right, so then the next thing we need to talk about is you'd be given these numbers, or at least most of them, right, and find the rest by subtracting. But the observed counts, that's observed. Expected counts, how do you find those? So let's talk about expected counts. So let's say I want to find this one right here. I'm going to call it X. If I want to find this expected count, the idea is if all of these categories are the same distribution for the three populations, then that means that this number out of 30 should be the same as the marginal distribution. The conditional probability of this category should be the same as the overall total, which is the marginal probability. Actually, that's a 50 over the 140. And that's kind of logical that you take these four numbers and you put them into a proportion. And if that is true, then if that's true for every cell, then that would mean that the conditional distribution for all three populations is the same. That's what we're testing for. So let's solve this with some algebra, right? X would equal, you'd cross multiply 30 times 50, and you divide it by the 140. And you'd end up with something like 10.7, which is the number that goes in that spot if they're all the same. That's my expected count. I could theoretically do that for every single cell on here, but technically I would really only have to do it for 6 cells, and I could find the rest by subtracting. So officially, the formula for expected counts is the column total. That's where the 30 came from. Times the row total. That's the 50, the 30 and the 50 are the column total and the row total divided by the grand total. And you would do that for each cell in the table. Here's the grand total. Let me put a few more arrows. The 30 is the column total. The 50, can I make this neat? I'm going to try. The 50 is the row total. So it's just kind of a common sense thing based on the idea of a proportion. We're assuming our null hypothesis is that all three of these populations have the same distribution. And so we calculate our expected counts based on that assumption. So we're, I'll write that as a sentence. Calculate expected counts based on the assumption, also called the null hypothesis, that all the populations are the same. All right, so that's your introduction. Then from there, you would take all your expected counts, you would take each individual one and subtract, I'm sorry, your observed counts, subtract the expected counts, square them, divide them, do that for every cell in the table, and add them all up. We're gonna talk some more about that in the next lesson. So for right now, that is all you need, because in the homework, they're not gonna ask you to go the next step yet, but it's coming soon.